know, we are now almost at the end. We are at the end of a series which has turned out to be a marathon, 9 weeks into the Apostle Creed. Now, maybe by now already, in your dreams, you're already having nightmares about this, and I hope that's not the case. But I will have a wonderful news for you today. Today is the last one, right? Next week we'll move on to something else, right? And today we are talking really, actually, the theme today is not really part of the Apostle Creed, right? If you look for it, you won't find it in the Apostle Creed, which we are going to read just now. But I think it's overarching it. You find it everywhere, not explicitly, but implicitly. It's actually the word "I believe." And every time in the Apostle Creed, and you have it, I think, 4 or 6 times, which says, "I believe, I believe, I believe, I believe, I believe." Now, normally I should have started by this, right? Normally I should have started by this and explained that, okay, well, what does the "I believe" mean? And then we move on into the Apostle Creed. But I chose to do it otherwise, and if it works, good. If it doesn't work, forgive me for that. But I chose to do it otherwise, because in the end, all this thing can be head knowledge. And so it's good to know that the way the Bible looks at faith is very different from the way we actually tend to talk about it. So today we're talking about "I believe" in faith. And I think a good question will be, what is faith? What is faith? Have you ever stopped and asked yourself that question? What is faith? There is a dictionary. It's called the Webster Collegiate Dictionary. Now, Webster. Yeah, that's what it's called, Webster. I never read that word. I always look at the web something coming, and I just jump. And this is what it says. Faith has two main meanings. Now, the first meaning is trust, allegiance to duty, right? So it's almost like loyalty, right? So faith is trust, allegiance to duty or a person. The other word for it is loyalty. Now, the second definition for faith is firm belief in something for which there is no proof. Firm belief in something for which there's no proof. So somebody actually believes or trusts in something strongly, but there's no proof. And let me say that I would argue that when I ask the question, what is faith, chances are your answer was the second one. Because we know in church that's what we have. You know, faith is you trust in something, there's no proof. So let's say we say the moon is red. Well, we believe that the moon is red. Is the moon red? Well, we don't know. There's no proof, but we may choose to believe that it's red. Firm belief in something where there's no proof. Many a time they say, you must believe that Jesus is going to heal you. You must have faith. What we are really saying to people is close your eyes and hope that it happens. Now, I don't know if you have heard of the story of the ostrich. Have you ever heard of the story of the ostrich? No. Now, the ostrich is a bird, right? It's a bird with very long feet and a very long neck and a small little head, and it's really, really big in the middle, right? And the ostrich, generally, what they say, I've never actually seen this myself. I've seen an ostrich, but I've never seen this. Now, I'm told that when the ostrich is near predator, or it's surrounded by predators, right? The first thing the ostrich does is what? It runs. And when the ostrich can't run, what the ostrich does, it takes its neck and brings it back within its wings, which are really, really big, and it hides it. And it just pretends that nothing is there. It has faith, isn't it? And I think sometimes that's what they ask us in church. In places like this, they say, just close your eyes. Ignore everything else that is around you and just trust and believe. A similar scenario is a father sitting in a plane. Now, most of you might know planes, you know, avion, a plane. And the father is reading and the son is playing. And all of a sudden, the child looks on the side in the window and sees one of the engine is burning and it's on fire. So the son turns to the father and says, "Father, this thing is burning." And everybody's a little bit panic in the plane. And the father says to the child, to calm the child, "Just close your eyes. Do as if there's nothing happening." Right? Close your eyes. And many of us, I want a job, so I close my eyes and I hope there's a job. There's no proof that I'm going to get a job, but I, you know what? I have faith. I sit at my house and I just close and I'm like, I'm sick. I'm not going to go see the doctor because I have faith. You know, I'm just going to do well. Well, how do you know? I'm going to do well because I have faith. There's no proof. Let me say that that's not biblical faith. That is positive thinking. Now, you can think positive and you can think of all the good things. That is not biblical faith. You see, biblical faith is different. Biblical faith, and that's what that's the whole point today. Biblical faith is a personal, trustful commitment based upon God's promises. It's a trustful commitment. Personal, I. Trustful, I believe, I trust. Commitment, action. So I do this because I trust this. And what is it that I trust is what God has said. Or it's because of who God is. So biblical faith is not a faith that doesn't have proof. It's not just a belief in something, a firm belief in something, and there's no proof. No, biblical faith is a firm belief that leads to action based on who God is and what He has said or what He has revealed Himself. So when Christians say, I have faith or I believe, they're not saying, I close my eyes and I just hope that things happen. You know, there's a word for it in English. It's called the leap of faith, right? You know, you just jump and you hope that things are going to be well. It doesn't work like that in the Bible. So my hope this evening and my goal is really to encourage you and me to be genuine believers. And what is being a genuine believer? What is to be a true believer? Well, it should be somebody who trusts God, and based on that trust, he acts upon it. You act. There is trust, there is action. And all this is based upon God and what He said. It's not upon me closing my eyes and falling. My hope is to encourage us to be genuine believers, having and displaying biblical faith, which is a personal. And sometimes it can be collective, but I do want to insist on the personal, trustful commitment based upon what God has revealed Himself. The big question really I hope to ask at the end of the service, and if you forget everything else, you might remember my question and try and figure out an answer to that question is my faith translated into action? Because if my faith is not translated into action, it's not biblical faith. It can be anything else. It can be knowledge. It can be whatever. But it's not biblical faith. Biblical faith is always translated into action. It's because I believe. Like Paul says, we spoke because we believe. I speak because I believe. So we will ask the question, what is biblical faith? And you know already, I've said that to you. It is a trustful commitment. It's a personal trustful commitment. Right, based upon God's word. So we will start with the first section, trustful commitment, and then we will move on to personal, and then we will try and apply this. Now let me quickly say we are going to do one thing that I almost forgot to do. We are going to read the Apostle Creed, and then let me also say that I come from a school of thought where what I'm going to preach now looks a little bit more like a topical preaching, right? So the passage that I've used does not necessarily explain everything that I'm going to say. And you'll bear with me for today, I hope. And I hope that it's never going to happen anytime soon, right? Dear Donne is smiling. Right. Is it ready? Okay, I don't know. Is the Apostles' Creed ready then? Good. Well, I'll just read it. And if it's there, you can read with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of the heaven and the earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the place of the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Christ Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Good. trustful commitment. That's what we said. Faith is a personal, I believe it's a personal, trustful commitment based upon God and what He's revealed Himself. So our first point is, faith is a trustful commitment. It's action from truth. Right. Faith is a trustful commitment. It's action that springs from truth. Now in Romans chapter 4, we have this wonderful story that is told to us about Abraham. Now come with me to verse 3. And it says, "For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now, to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due." Now come with me to verse 20 of that same chapter. Chapter 4, verse 20. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. Right. Now, I think Paul here is giving us an example. Now, Paul, if you know a little bit of Romans, he started in Romans chapter 1 saying, "I have this wonderful news about humanity, that man is not going to die any longer. God has made a way. God has made a way through his son." And so he moves on to chapter 1, end of chapter 1, and then chapter 2, explaining the difficulties and the trouble that in which man find himself. Man has rejected God, and therefore God is going to punish man, and God is going to kill man. Well, literally kill man and cause him to die. But what he says else is, if man comes back and trusts in what God has done, then there is a possibility for man to get out. And so in chapter 3, he shows kind of all mankind has gone wrong, but God has provided a way for man to be right with him. And in chapter 4 now, he kind of shows us that God has done this, but this comes through faith. It comes through trust. It comes through trustful commitment. And so in chapter 4, he gives an example. What is the example he talks about? He talks about Abraham. And he says Abraham was counted, believed God in verse 3, and he was counted to him as righteousness. What is he saying? He's saying Abraham trusted in what God said. Verse 20, he moves on to tell us, why is it that Abraham was counted righteousness? Now the word righteousness, again, let me quickly explain this, is how does man get in good, friendly relationship with God? How can man stand before God and not be punished by God? And that's what the Bible uses as righteousness. And so here we see that Abraham was not counted righteous just because he had a leap of faith, just because he believed in something he didn't know. No, Abraham believed God. Now that's interesting. He says Abraham believed God. Abraham trusted God. Abraham was committed to God and who God is. Now if you look there in verse 20, what did Abraham believe about God? What did he trust about God? Well, it says it, that God was able to do what he had promised. So Abraham's faith was not a faith based on no proof. Abraham's faith was trust in what God had said. He didn't just close his eyes and think, yeah, things are going to be good. No, he had God's promise, and he had to choose whether he was going to agree that God's promise would come true or not. Now, we are going to go and look for ourselves what is it that Abraham believes. So come with me, Genesis chapter 12. Now this passage that we see in Romans, first of all, referred to a passage in Genesis chapter 15. We're going to read that just now. Now I want us to read these two passages to see what were the promises and how they evolve and why is it Paul bring them down there. Now Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to verse 4, I'm going to read. "Now the Lord said to Abraham, 'Go from your country, your kindred, your father's house, to the land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonor you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed.' Now what do we have here? We have God who calls Abraham and says, well, this is what I want to do with you, and this is what I promised to do. Now if you go, you will go from your house, and I'm going to be with you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you a land. I'm going to give you a nation, descendant. I'm going to make you a great nation, and I'm going to keep my hand of blessing over you. Now we flip a few chapters later on, chapter 16, it's probably one or two pages on your right, and we will start again from verse 1. And we see a few years later, Abraham. Now most of you might know the story about Abraham. Abraham had a wife, Sarah, and Sarah never had a child. She was barren. And so when God is saying to Abraham in chapter 12, I will make you a great nation. Now Abraham is maybe 60 or 70, so it's still okay. You know what? He still has great hope. Now we are in chapter 16. Abraham is getting close and close, and years have gone past. Chapter 16, verse 1. Now Sarah, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children. She had a female Egyptian servant. Oh no, what am I saying? Sorry, it's 15. Genesis 15, right. Genesis 15, verse 1 to 6. Sorry for that. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Fear not, Abraham, I'm your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abraham said, O Lord, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus. And Abraham said, behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and number the stars, if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. Now you see that same verse, that same exact sentence came back in Romans chapter 4. Now what we have here is a man whom God told something. This is what God says. And God says, I'm going to make you into a great nation. Now a few years later, he still doesn't have a child. God takes him, and this is the wonderful thing about God. God doesn't ask people to believe with no basis. In a vacuum. God takes him outside. And God says, count. If you can count, then no. I'm going to give you as many, and probably more. Abraham believed. Why? Because God gave him his word. God gave him his promise. He was not asked to believe in the blank, out of nothing. He was called upon to act based on God's promises, based on God's revelation about himself. God promised, and Abraham had a choice. He could choose to trust or not trust. God had called him. Abraham had a choice. He could choose to trust or not trust. And believe me, if Abraham did not choose to trust God and act upon the trust, well, it wouldn't be, because God did not give him his promise, and God had not showed him that he is capable of doing it. So biblical faith is not a faith that is based on nothing. It's a call to response. It's a call to trust. It's a call to commitment. It's a call to action based on the truth of God, on who he is, what his character is, but also based on what he has done in the past. You see, what Abraham knew about God will push him to decide on whether he was going to trust God or not. That's why it was a big mistake for him to have this slave in chapter 16 and trying to scheme to have a child. That's why it was wrong. Why was it wrong? Because he did not choose to trust. Another great passage about faith, and that's in Hebrews chapter 11. So you come with me to Hebrews chapter 11. I think it's very difficult in Christian circles to preach about faith without looking at Hebrews 11. Now, Hebrews 11 is called the hall of faith, right? It's not the hall of fame, it's the hall of faith. It's a place where you move and you see pictures of great guys who trusted God, and they're telling you one after the other. Now, faith is assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received the commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous. God commended him by accepting his gift, and through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. Now, before he was taken up, he was commended as having pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear, constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise, as in foreign land, living in tent with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundation, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefrom, from one man and him as good as dead were born descendants, as many as the stars of heaven, and as many as innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. Now, I hope you have noticed something here. Each time somebody was called upon to act in faith, there was God's promise, and because they trusted in God's promise, they acted. There was trust and there was action. The action flew from the trust, and the trust was based upon what God said, what God promised. So although the things they were promised were not things they could see, but that promise was not absent. It was not faith in something that does not exist. It was not faith with no proof. No, it was, if God is saying this, and this God is trustworthy, then this is how I should act. So I hope you've noticed that pattern, my dear friend. It's assurance, conviction that leads to action. It's trust that leads to action. Now, I want us to go back to that Romans chapter 4 again, and remember that it says, it's Abraham believed God. So biblical faith is less about it's less about the trust process and more about who we are trusting. It's less about the action of believing and more about the object of our belief. And biblical faith calls people to trust in God. The object of our trust is God and what he can do, and less our process of trusting. So faith in itself has no value unless the person we're trusting is trustworthy and able to do what he promised. And so every time you saw Jesus saying, your faith has healed you in the Bible, he's not saying because you just trusted and you had this positive thinking and that it's, no. He's saying you chose the right person to trust, and because of that choice, then you're healed. So the principle is very clear, isn't it? Biblical faith is action from truth. Trust based on what God has said that leads to commitment. Now, if that's biblical faith, then I think the biggest problem of man, it's a problem of trust. And I would actually argue that sin can be redefined as a lack of trust. Now, if you go back to Eden, to Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, what was their problem? Their problem was not just eating the fruit. The fruit wasn't the problem. The problem was, could they trust God? Could they trust that God knows better? Could they trust that God is good? Could they rely fully on the trust that they have in God and therefore act accordingly? You see, sin now can be redefined as a lack of trust. Every time people sin, every time people reject God's rule, it's because they don't trust Him. They don't think it's good for them. They don't think He knows best. They don't think He has their best interests at heart. And that takes us to the wonderful message of the gospel, isn't it? The wonderful message of the gospel is that man did not choose to trust God. And because man did not choose to trust God, man has messed up the world. Now, I don't have to tell you that the world is broken. You just have to look around. Watch the news. I was actually, I don't know who told me this. Was this? I can't remember, but I watched this somewhere. And apparently there's a TV in Russia that decided that for a few minutes, for one day, I think, for one day, they will just show good news, right? They will not show bad news. So when you watch the news, what do you hear? They rape somebody, they kill somebody, airport crash, right? And the people were like, but that's not news, right? We want to have good news. So for one day, we are going to have good news. And apparently, guess what? Who watched them? Very few people. Nobody watched them. Their rating, that's what they call how many people watched them. It went like this. Because we are so used to that. And we know how broken the world is. And that's why when we watch the news, we want to know how broken it is. The Bible says that's God's initial judgment. The world is broken. It's broken, Romans 1, because God has started judging it. So spiritual death, lack of connection with God, will lead to men destroying the world. Men hurting one another. But that's just a small little picture of what will happen later on when we have the big judgment of God, which is eternal judgment, eternal death, eternal punishment. But the wonderful news that we find in the gospel, and this is what Paul is arguing in Romans chapter 4, is that it is possible for men to avoid that. And how can men avoid that? Well, men avoids that not by going to church, not by praying, not by doing all the things, by trusting God. Men can avoid that judgment by trusting in God. And what does men trust in God? Now come with me to Romans chapter 4, and then I will show you where we start. Verse 22, that is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the word it was counted to him was not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believed in him, who raised from the dead Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. That's the wonderful news. Is I put my trust in God, and I believe that God not only sent his son on earth, and that son lived a perfect life, and the son died on the cross, but I believe, I trust firmly that son died on that cross in my place, on my behalf. He was raised for my justification. And therefore, if I trust that what God says is true, if I trust that what the son says is true, then I know I'm right with God. That's what Paul says. So it's a choice that me and you have to make. Are we going to trust God? Are we going to trust in what we do? Or are we going to trust God? Are we going to trust that what he did on that cross was enough for me to be right with him? And therefore act accordingly, act knowing that I am right with God? Or are we going to do our best and see how far we get? But I think if you read carefully, you will realize that it won't get you anywhere. Biblical faith is not based on nothing, right? It is anchored on truth, the truth that we find in the Bible, the truth of God as he revealed himself to different people through history and through the Bible. It is because of who God is that I can trust him. It is because of who God is that now I can act. And although people don't know where I'm going, although I might not even go where I'm going, but I trust that God knows. So I'm not acting out of nothing. I'm acting based on what God has said and what he's revealed. Trustful commitment. Truth from action. Action that springs from truth. I want to ask one or two questions and then we can move on. You say you believe. Do you act on it? Do you have specific action that springs from what you trust about who God is? Does your knowledge of God stay in your head, or is it translated into action? Now there's a concept that I heard somebody say it the first time, and I was like, wow, he's so right. He said in church there is a disease these days. And the disease in church is what we call practical atheists. It's people who believe all the wonderful things about God, And they know the Bible from A to B, from, you know, Genesis 1 to Revelation 22. They know all these wonderful things they have in their house, the 14 names of God. You know, I can't even say all of them, but they haven't. And yet in their life, you don't see it. They just live like people who don't know anything. Can God provide? Oh yes, I know God can provide. But then why are you corrupt? Because you don't trust that God can provide. Can God protect? Yes, I know God protects. But then, why are you going to see those people? Anyway. So my question is, are you also one of those practical atheists? What you know about God is in your head, and that's it. You can't see it in action. It's not there. Now, sometimes we inherit that. Sometimes me and you, we went to school and they taught us all these things, and we went to Sunday school and teach us all these things, and we are born in a church, in a home where they sing every day, and you learn how to pray, and you know when you raise your hand, and you know when you raise your voice, and you know when you're supposed to cry, because that's how it works. But I'm asking, is it springing from a trust in God? Or is it just stuff that you're doing? Because if it's stuff that you're doing, just stop. You're wasting your time. You're wasting your time. Biblical faith is not based out of nothing. It's based upon God's word and God's character and God's promises. But that should lead us into action. And actually, we are studying the book of James in the Frank service. And the big theme of James is what? Why do you believe so much stuff about God and you don't do it? Do it! Show me that you can do it, then I know that you believe it. Now, I'll come back to that just now. It is a personal faith, right? It is personal. It's not just I believe, it's not just I have a trustful commitment, it's not just I act upon what I know about God. It's also personal. It's not collective, right? Now, let me first say that it is a choice. Faith is a gift, and I don't argue about it. God gives it to us in a wonderful way. That's not the point here. I'm not arguing about that now. But I'm arguing as well that it is a choice. Now, if you look at that verse 3, it says, Romans 4, it says, what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God. Now, in English, there is what they call passive verbs and active verbs, right? What is a passive verb? What is a passive verb? Somebody? You guys are studying English. What is a passive verb? Okay, so you almost, it's just happening to you. You can't do anything about it. Now give me one. Well, on top of your head, right? Sorry. A passive verb? What? Okay? Yeah, I want an example. I was broken. I was arrested. It just happened to me. I was broken. I was insulted. That's passive. And then there's active. I broke. I insulted. I arrested. I'm acting, right? What did you see here? Is it Abraham? Believed. It's active. It's a choice. Now, move with me. Let's go back again to verse 18. Verse 18. In hope he believed against all hope. Right? When everybody else says, you can't trust, he says, I choose to trust. You old, I choose to trust. You can't just leave and go wandering. You don't know where you're going. I choose to trust. In hope against hope he believed that he should become the father of many nations, as he had been told, so shall your offspring be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, or what he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God. It is personal. It is the I choose. And that's why Hebrews become very important. And that's why I understand sometimes that people can mislead others and think that biblical faith is believing something out of nothing. No. It's That is based on the reality, present, and where you are going. So where you are going is almost unknown to people's eyes, but God has told you what's going to happen. God has promised to walk with you. And so now it's raining and you are waiting for the sun. But it's raining. And you look at your TV, the guy from the, you know, weatherman or meteo, he tells you it's not going to be sunny for the next 40 years. But you say, no, God says it's going to be sunny. I trust God. It's not out of the blue. It's based on what God has said. It's based on who God is. But it's a choice. Faith doesn't happen to you. It's not a passive thing. It just happened to me. I had faith. No, it's active. And I would argue that biblical faith, it almost calls us to position ourselves based on what God has said daily. It's every day. Do I really believe that God is good? Do I really believe that God can help me? Do I really believe that God can heal me? Do I really believe that God can come through? Do I really believe? It's every day, every moment. That's the question. Do you? And I hope the answer is, I do. So biblical faith is a choice. It's a choice we make every time. Is God the one who's saying the truth, or is my parents saying the truth? Is my tribe going to look after me? Is God going to look after me? Is my money going to look after me? Is God going to look after me? These are questions that we have, but it's a choice. It can't just happen to you. You have to make it. Faith is not inherited. I hear many people say, I was brought up in a Christian home. Yes, that's your parents' faith. What is yours? And that's where things like, you know, this body of truth that we believe, and I know there is a collective point in this, but they can be very dangerous. We can read the Apostle Creed and say, I learned that when I was young. My pastor preached through that the whole 2 months. But is that your faith? Is that the thing you have chosen? And that's where now you look at the Apostle Creed. The Apostle Creed says, I believe. Now, we read it, and if you want, I can reread that to you again. And he says, I believe in God, not we believe. Now, of course, the whole church is saying it. But it's a personal choice. This is what I know to be truth. And based on this truth, I trust God and I'm going to act upon it. So let me ask you a question, right? We say we believe in God. Do you believe in God? Is this like really something you're convinced there is a God out there? And that God is the creator of heaven and the earth. And that God is almighty and he's a father. Do you believe that? That moves you to action. Do you believe that there is a man who was born, his name is Jesus, and he's the son of God, and he was conceived in a miraculous way. He lived, suffered for you, was crucified for you, died for you, and then he rose again the third day. Do you believe that? Is that like something you know to be true and you choose to trust to be true? Or is it something that you seen? Do you believe there is such thing as the Holy Spirit that he inhabits every Christian that is in you and is busy transforming you and working through you? Or is it something that you know in your head and you haven't chosen to? Do you believe that there is such thing as the church, as communion of saints, that all God's children are part of a family and that you belong to a family of God? Do you believe that? Where is the action? Do you believe that there's forgiveness of sin, that your sins have been forgiven, and the sins of everybody else can be forgiven? And are you calling them into that this forgiveness? Do you believe that once this life is over, you will raise again from the dead and be with Jesus forevermore? Is that something you look forward to? There's a man that just encouraged me so much in my Christian walk and impressed me. And there's a few mannerisms. So when you see me preaching, and it's okay. One day if you see him and you see him, you see those mannerisms coming. But he's impressed me so much. And this is one thing that I like about him. Every day it's his birthday, and it's in March 25th. When everybody's singing every birthday, you know what he always says? Nicholas, one more year before I'm with the Lord. And it shocked me the first time I heard it. And I thought, well, what can he say? He's a pastor. But he says that again and again and again, because it's just so in him that even small things like a birthday, he's just like, I look forward to being with heaven. I was talking to a friend lately and he says, this man is on a mission to be with Jesus before the end of the year. I'm like, ooh. Well, anyway, but I'm just saying, there is somebody who believes this. There is somebody who believes this. It's not just a head knowledge. It's moved into something that you can see in his life.
See, biblical faith is that, based on what God has promised, we take action and we choose to take action, and people can see that into our lives.
Personal conviction that leads to trust, and trust that leads to commitment, and commitment that leads to action. Now, I'm going to finish on a very kind of personal note and ask a few questions. Because the application here is I believe in faith. And that's what we've been saying every day. I believe in God. I believe in the church. I believe in communion. That's good. But is this things that lead us to action? Is it things that create action in our life? Because if biblical faith is a personal decision to act upon what we know about God, to act upon what we trust about God, and what God has revealed in His Word, then I need to pay attention on what I do with the Word of God. Because the more I know about God, the more I'll trust Him, and the more I'll act. The less I know about God, the less I'll trust Him, and the less I will act. So how I read my Bible and what I do with my Bible, how I read it and the way I read it is very important. Do I study it? Do I try and understand the mind of God so as I can act upon it? Now, here's a few challenges, and I encourage you to think about this. Now, I don't know where you are. I don't know what God is saying to you. But I do know that what He's calling us to do today is to stop and ask ourselves, what do we believe about God? Does it impact our life? Because if it doesn't, it's not biblical faith. It's not. You know a lot about God. You can get a PhD on that. You can get a degree on that. And that's okay. But don't go out and say that you trust God. You don't. All these wonderful truths we know about God, do they make our life different? Now, I want you to read with me Matthew chapter 6. Because I want us to read this, and we're not going to be too long. But I want us to read this passage together. Because I think these are just a few. I mean, there's so many other challenging passages in the Bible that calls us to action. But Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Now, anybody knows the passage by heart? Nobody knows the passage by heart, right? Chapter 6, verse 33. When you look at your future, when you are making a decision where you are going to live, what you are going to do, what are the criteria you use? Matthew chapter 6 says what? But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Now, what are the things He's talking about? He's talking about food and clothes and where you're going to sleep and what you're going to do. Those are the things He's talking about. And in verse 34 He says, and I'll come back to it in a few seconds, but He says, do not be anxious about this. Are we going to trust God or not? It's easy for us to say, I trust God because I'm sick. Because it's stuff you can't do. Do I trust God that if I seek His kingdom, He will look after me? And therefore my priorities in life are seeking His kingdom? Or am I trying to build my own kingdom and seeking my own things, and then I will try and patch up God's kingdom to it while I've succeeded? You see, many of us, if they ask you, is this really the primary thing, primary motto of your life? Is this the thing that you're pursuing? Let me correct a little bit. People here might think pursuing God's kingdom is becoming a pastor. That's wrong, right? It's very, very wrong. It says seek the kingdom of God. Seek to expand the kingdom of God. And that can be through being a doctor or a lawyer or whatever. It can be in any field of life. But are you pursuing the kingdom of God where you are? Or are you pursuing money and connection, your own security and satisfaction? You see, it's one thing to say, I believe. It's one thing to pick up your Bible, put it under your eyes, and come to church with a lot of amens. Are you pursuing the kingdom of God in your business, in your relationship, in everything? Romans 8, chapter 1. Well, let's just do this now, right? Verse 31 to 34 of Matthew 6. We are still in Matthew 6. Jesus is saying wonderful things. What is He saying? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Verse 34. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself, sufficient for the day with its own trouble. When you think about life, is this what you take on and you say, God says I shouldn't be worried about this. God will look after me.
Right.
I'll tell you, you know, like it's almost a bit of a confession, but I think 3/4 of my stress is because I don't obey this. Most of the time, I'm thinking, what's going to happen tomorrow? You know, what's going to happen 5 years? What's going to happen 10 years? Jesus says, don't worry about those things. Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4 verse 10. It's all verses that we know, and some people might even memorize them and know them by heart. Philippians chapter 4 verse 10, he says, I rejoice in the Lord greatly. Now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I'm speaking out of being in need, for I've learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to be abound. In any and every circumstances, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and anger, abundance and in need. Verse 13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Do we believe that? Do we believe that we can do all things through him who strengthens us? And therefore we can endure suffering, we can endure plenty, we can endure lack, because we know through him, I can withstand anything. You see, Paul believed, that's why he acted. He believed that God could strengthen him, and so he endured all things. When you think of death, when you're going to die, now, I know at our age it's not a very good thought, and very few people actually think of when they're going to die at our age, because we think we're invincible, right? The truth is, many of us are going to die anyway. There's people your age, my age, younger than us, born the same day, or probably younger, who are dying now as we speak. So we're not exempt of this. But John chapter 11, verse 25, that's a good place. Now, Jesus has just raised Lazarus from the dead. And Africans, I know, isn't it, Fidel? We are scared of dying. Eh? We don't want to die. If they ask you, what is the last thing you want on your list, you put death. I was going to tell you a story, but I don't have much time, right? Maybe I should tell you. A guy is visited by death, right? And death visits this guy and says, I've come to take you. He's African, right? And he says, hey, what do I do with this guy? I don't want to die now. So he smiles and laughs and whatever, and says, okay, give me a few minutes. I'll give you my food, right? So eat. Death is like, this is such a warm welcome. I've never received a welcome like this. Good, thank you. Give me food. And can you get me some water? I've been wandering around the earth and I'm really thirsty. So the guy goes to his kitchen and puts a little bit of diazepam or whatever, you know, to make people sleep. You know, huge dose like this. And he gives it to death. Death now drinks. It's like, this is awesome. And then, now I'm even feeling sleepy. I'm going to sleep and I'll rest for a few minutes. And the guy quickly goes into the bag that death has and looks at the list. Takes his name from the top and puts it at the bottom. Right, he's African. I want to be the last to die. And then a few hours later, death wakes up and says, you've been so kind to me. And I'm going to do what I never do to anybody. I'm going to start at the bottom of the list. We Africans, we don't like dying, right? But when you're faced with death, what comes to your mind? You see, this passage should come to our mind. When we're faced with death, our death or the death of a friend. Verse 25, what does it say? I'm the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he dies, he shall live. And everybody who lives and believes in me shall never die. The question Jesus says is, do you believe us? Do you believe that even if they take your life now, you're not going to die? And therefore, death is not something you fear. This is not the worst thing that can happen to you. And hopefully next time you visited, you don't change your name on that list, right? Romans 8 chapter 1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Do you believe that? Do you believe that I've accepted Jesus and therefore there's no condemnation? God is not angry with me. No, I don't see that, because many people I meet, the child fails at school. Oh God, are you angry with me?
There's rain outside and he's putting his best attire. He's like, God, what did I do wrong? Can you rejoice in what Jesus has done and just apply that onto your life and say, God, I know that you're not angry with me anymore. And I know maybe life is hard and things are difficult, but I know you're not angry with me anymore because of what Jesus has done.
Do we believe those things? Or is it that we don't? Because if we do believe those things, they should be seen in our life. If we are scared of death, then we don't believe that there is a resurrection of life. We don't believe that Jesus says that even though we die, we'll be alive with him. We don't believe that. We don't even believe that heaven is much better than hell. We don't believe it. 2 Peter, and I'm going to finish by there. I'll end there because our time is gone. I'll end there. 2 Peter. Now, as Christians, sometimes when we are in the church, sometimes we feel that we are missing out on something outside. As Christians, sometimes we feel that God did not give us everything. God is hiding something. And 2 Peter says, is it true? Come with me to verse 3. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 3. His divine power has granted us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he granted us his precious and great promises, so that through them you may become partaker of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. Now, my friend, let me ask this, and maybe I should rephrase it in the best way that Paul says. Are we content? Do we believe that God has given us everything that we need in that book? Through his promises, we have everything for this life and the life to come. Now, I have, as a pastor here in Africa, I have to answer this question many times. Somebody came with a vision and he could tell me my whole life. What do I do with him? And I'm like, do you believe that God has told you everything that you need for this life and the life to come in his word? Then you tell that guy, thank you very much for telling me, but I already know everything. No, we don't, do we? Actually, sometimes we are the one going there and say, tell me about my life. Tell me what's going to happen tomorrow. Tell me. And then we get abused because we're not content. There's a wonderful passage, Exodus 29, 29, and it says, Deuteronomy. Now forget whatever the passage is. But it says something, the same thing. It says, what God has revealed to you is for you and the children. And what God has kept is not for you to know. Yet we don't believe that. As Christians, we don't believe that. Because if we did, we wouldn't be running around asking for prophecies and words of prophecies and whatever. We would say, I have everything that I need. And although I'm confused, I have everything that God wants me to. So a faith that is not translated into action, my dear friend, is not biblical faith. I don't know what it is. It's not biblical faith. It must change the way we see reality. It must change the way we see things. It might add color to reality. We will see things that nobody else sees. It's almost like everybody watching a game on a black and white TV and you're watching a game on a plasma TV. You're seeing way more than they're seeing. And of course, the person watching in black and TV will say, you don't see clearly, but you know you do because yours is more colorful. So what are you going to do today so as your trust can be more and full in God? Why not start with a prayer? And that's what we're going to do. Why don't we start with a prayer? Why don't you, when you go home, make a list of the things, the areas that you feel like, I'm not trusting God here, and I need to. And I believe firmly in what it says here, but I'm not trusting. There's no action in my life. Why not make a list? Why not find a friend here, somebody you trust? Preferably from your own gender, right? Somebody you trust, except for Mark and his wife, right? Somebody you trust and tell that person, right, these are areas that I think I'm not trusting God. Can you, when we meet, remind me of this? Can you challenge me on this? Because in the end, my dear friend, if your faith is not translated into commitment, then it's not biblical faith. Let's bow our heads.